It suddenly dawned on me that some of the problems I've been having with trying to cut dadoes and rabbets with my circular saw in rough lumber for some of the rough lumber projects that I've been doing, and there'll be other videos of those elsewhere on the channel. It was more than just a question of waxing the shoe on the circular saw. Now that's important, and it's a step you should take, and I'm going to go ahead and buff on some paste wax. But it dawned on me I needed another tool, and the tool I needed was something that combined the power of a speed square, wherein you would try to make a cut. So, presuming this is my board, I just slap that on there and then run my circular saw along the edge of the speed square to do my cut. However, I needed something to be able to hold on to, say, a 2x4 and make these kind of cuts and be able to work my way along the width of the dado or the rabbet and not have a decreasing amount of support for my saw where it's walking around, cutting too deep, cutting too shallowly. And I realized that I've been a dope. What I need is a small saw board combined with a speed square of sorts, and preferably something that I could hook over the edges of a board, maybe a 2x4, maybe a 2x6, maybe even a 2x8, and be able to clamp down on that. So what I'm going to build next is a jig that dawned on me while I was in the shower this morning that would make this easier and give me a guide that will always have a solid amount of wood that the shoe of the circular saw can ride on. I've talked way too much in some of my recent videos, so unless I've got a specific comment on something that were a tricky part, the rest of this should just fly by. Yeah. Gotten a little bit runny. Make sure you get the edge. This is where your saw is going to be riding against the saw board and against the jig. I'm also going to wax the surface of the jig and try to impregnate the wood with as much wax as possible so I don't have to always pre-wax the circular saw blade. Set that aside, let it dry, move on to step two. That's 3 3/4. Check that again. 3 3/4 from kerf to edge of shoe. Doesn't matter, I'm going to cut the plate foot on the jig a little bit long, and then on the first cut, I'll trim that. I love sawdust. More sawdust. This is so awesome. Nothing says I'm a little confused better than taking the time to actually organize the little bits of shit in your crap bucket. That generally means you don't know exactly what you're doing, and you probably ought to go sit down and draw a sketch first.
Aha!
Okay, when in doubt, either make a drawing or do a mock-up. Here's what I've got so far. Got the circular saw, and this is the example piece I'm using. And I've got a piece of plywood that I will end up ripping a slightly smaller in width and cutting to a shorter length because I don't need to extend all the way down this far. These two clamps are holding on what will serve as a guide line or guide fence for the edge of the shoe, and the edge of this will probably be brought in a little bit. This does not need to be very wide. This piece is going to be cut square and will be the T section of what would ordinarily be part of the speed square. So if your speed square goes on a piece like this, and this is your guide edge, well, this piece that hooks on the section that hooks on the piece to be cut, that's this right here. The other thing I'm playing with, though, is I want to be able to cut some different width boards. I don't want a long jig. This is meant for doing just 2x4s, 2x6s, maybe 2x8s. I don't want to get much longer than that because it starts to get unwieldy. But the question I now have is, with all of this, I need one hand to run the saw and make the cut, and I need one hand to hold this. Now, I can span a 2x4. I could not span a 2x6 and hold it in place, and I don't want to have a lot of extra material here to have something where I grab hold. So what I do have are these. These are really cheap as in garbage and cheap as in inexpensive clamps that I got from Harbor Freight. They work okay for gluing. They're basically just speed clamps, but they don't work great. They don't have a lot of holding power. You can't crank them down the way you can with the good ones. One thing I noticed about these, the way the mechanism seems to work, when you clamp them on something and you run them up, they won't hold pressure, but you can apply extra pressure with the clamp. Now, there's a keeper flap in here that binds against the main rod and tries to hold it in place, but if I take that out and I just use the compression rod that's tied to the trigger handle, that would be enough to hold it, and then when I let go of it, it would be loose and I could widen it back up. So it would go loose, I slide the jig down, I re-crank, I run my saw for my next cut, I let loose, slide the jig down, crank, run the saw. I think you get the idea. But that's what I've come up with, so I'm going to tear this guy apart. Wow, these are crap. No wonder they break. Okay, I was able to get to slide off. Each of these metal bars has a keeper C-clip, basically, that's jammed into a hole. I took one off one end. The way I got it out was to take a nail set, take a hammer. I had this propped up on a block of wood, and I just gave it a whack and knocked it out of the hole. And, of course, it proceeded to bounce somewhere in the shop, so I'll never find it again except when I step on it with my bare feet. That's how you get it apart. So now I should be able to take this back apart and get the keeper bar rather than the crank bar out, and the spring that holds the keeper bar in place. Once I do that, I'll put it back together and see if I can get the kind of action that I want out of the clamp, to where it will clamp only when I squeeze the trigger and then sort of slip and slide around the rest of the time. Because if that works, then I'm going to go ahead and figure out a way to bolt this onto the jig I showed you earlier. All right, nothing flying out at me. Right. Set that aside. Vice grips at the ready. Take the spring out. Try not to launch it across the garage. Op success. This guy back together, and we will speed through the rest of this for you so you don't have to be bored out of your skull. Yes, I had to take it back apart a third time because I am a moron. I took out the spring and I took out the keeper bar. I forgot to remove the little cute orange trigger that could float around and jam things up in there, because I'm a nitwit. Find something to do with that. But that's a useful spring, and a hunk of metal, probably not so much. But I'll keep the useful spring, and I'll keep the bright orange thummy button doodad for something. Anyway. Okay, back together. I've got all the bits removed. Now let's see how this works, if it produces any grip. Having to do this by hand to just feel. End up breaking a finger on camera for everybody. Crushed for your viewing pleasure, the nitwit. All right. So it slides freely enough, but if I pull it up tight on my hand and then squeeze the trigger, hey, hey, what do you know? That puts a pretty good grip on there. So I slide it up tight, give it a squeeze. Owie, owie. Let's see how it holds a piece of wood instead of my fragile little hand here. So, I go up, I put the jig on the wood, give it a squeeze. That is enough between the mass of the jig and the flat surfaces that will engage. That's enough to keep it from rocking around, and I can do things up to a pretty significant width. I think I'm onto something, by Jove. All right, I've had a slight change of plan in how I want to do this. Given the way the geometry of this thing works, where it closes in this direction by squeezing, it was difficult having it oriented this way to try to close and clamp the way I had it originally, because you're closing here, but you don't have a good grip. You're trying to use all your thumb power to clamp, which isn't as strong nearly as your fingers. It's more natural to hold it like this. So if I reverse which side or flip which side I put the T-square rail that is going to hold my jig square to the stock that's going to have the dado or rabbet cut in, and I mount this, as I still haven't figured that part out, but if I do it this way, it's easy to get set up. I slap the jig on, push this in, give it a clamp to hold it, and then I can grab my circular saw with my other hand and make my cut, release, use this to push it, the entire jig down the piece to be cut, reclamp, hit it with the circular saw, push down, reclamp. It's ergonomically just much better. All I gotta figure out is how to securely mount this little monkey to that T-rail. Okay, I just made two cuts, cuts on two pieces. Essentially, I took a 2x4 and I ripped it's about a foot long. It doesn't matter exactly in the lengthwise dimension. But I ripped off a piece and then I ended up shaving it. Most 2x4s are 1.5 thick, and I ended up shaving this down just a little bit. The exact amount doesn't matter. It's about 1.25 right now. I cut one. And this is the piece that is going to butt up against our the 2x4 that's going to get the dados. I cut this to 7/8 of an inch because the thickness on the tang of the clamp adds an additional 1/8 of an inch. So I should be able to shoot some 3/4 inch screws in here, or even a 1-inch screw at a slight angle, and not have any interference issues. Now, I need to make several more cuts in this piece. Yeah. After I cut a chunk out of this, these two pieces will then be screwed and glued to the main guide piece, and inside in that channel is where the clamp will ride. Okay, we are in the middle of constructing the jig. I am attaching the first part of the T-rail piece. I have already measured and squared everything. I'll give you the dimensions in a bit. I just wanted to show you. I tend to pre-drill using the countersink bit first, then I use a, I think it was a 1/8 bit to do my pilot hole. And I've sunk two screws partway in. I'm about to take this back apart now that I know that my alignment is right and that this will be square to my cutting surface or cutting edge here. I'm going to put some glue on here, just carpenter's glue, then put these back together and using the screws as my alignment, put it together, and I still have to drill the pilot hole and put a screw in here. And the screws should hold it while the glue dries. Okay, I have sunk my screws and they've gone down in the countersinking. I have cleaned up the glue. The important part is the glue on the underside here, because that edge is going to ride along any of the lumber that the jig will be trying to align your saw for. You'll notice I found an alternate use for my bucket of crap. It was enough to hold it here and I had it clamped. So now with this in place, I can begin to focus on setting up the fence. Now, the guide fence is actually in two parts. I decided to do it this way because I want to minimize the amount of friction. Pardon the wobble here. Essentially, what I've done is I've got a very straight cut piece. I burned the edge a little bit, a cut piece of plywood. And I've decided to take a polyethylene cutting board, and I've cut a 3/4 inch piece from that. I ripped that on the table saw, and you can see after you do the cut, it bows, which is why you either have to cut a dado, or in this case, I'm using the plywood as the master fence, and then this is just a slide block. And what I'll do is mount the plywood parallel to this cutting edge here, with sufficient gap such that the shoe of my circular saw will ride in here. But I want the shoe to ride against this edge of the polyethylene because it's pretty much frictionless. And that will help cut down on drag. And then really, I only have to wax this part of the surface. This may not be necessary, but I've got another project coming up where I want to use this stuff, so I need to get used to how to mill it and machine it and what it behaves like. So knowing that it will cup like this after you cut it loose from the main board was useful. Next step will be getting this piece trued up and glued and screwed in place, or tacked in place. I think I'm going to use 3/4 inch brads for that. Okay, I have just tacked down the first main guide rail with some 1-inch brad nails, and I offset it very precisely all the way along its length using a combination square here. And I have that, not that it matters because your saw will be different, but I happen to set it for, I think, 4 5/8. So now, I'm going to pre-drill the polyethylene, countersink them, and get them ready. And then I'm going to just work my way down and anchor this tight again, tightly against the wooden fence as I go. Something looked off to me, so I got out my calipers. There was about 0.8 millimeter difference thickness from one end of the polyethylene strip to the other. And I wasn't happy with that. So I took and I clamped down some, I think this is 60 or 80 grit sandpaper disc that I had. And you can see where I've worked slowly and shaved in different areas and gone along checking. I've now got it within 0.1 millimeter thickness from end to end. I checked a whole bunch of places in between. I know that's a little anal, but try to start out as accurate as you can. So now that I'm happy with that, I can go ahead and drill the holes and proceed. And then at that point, all that's left is a little bit of bandsaw work. I have to finish the detail work for the other portion of the T-rail and mount the cranking portion of the clamp handle to it. I'll show you how that works. And I'm going to be using a couple of screws drilled through this faceplate right here to get it initially set, and then this lag bolt is going to anchor it into the grain of this piece, about like that. This happened to be a 2.5 or 2 3/4 inch lag bolt I had laying around that had a wider shoulder on it, and it happens to fit in some spaces that the clamp had. And once I get that all worked out, I will be then gluing this all together and mounting it to this surface, the guide rail. That'll be the next step. Just sinking some 1-inch screws here very gently. I had it clamped, I pre-drilled my holes. And that looks good. Now the question is, did I punch through or did I get the thickness right? Same here. No screw tips. Means I did it right. That's very good. So all I got to do is sand a little bit, and we are good. Awesome. All right, so let's see. Next step is to do some cuts at the bandsaw. I've still got to do some fine tuning here, but essentially these will butt up against it, mostly like that. All right, it's the next day, roughly, not quite 24 hours later, maybe, and the profusion of clamps that you see is what I threw together as I glued on the last piece. I attached the back half of the slide rail, or T-rail here. It's in two pieces, as I demonstrated in the earlier segment, and here you can see some of the construction adhesive that I had smeared on here. I used construction adhesive to apply both of these pieces and to cement the clamp body to the jig. Reason being, it gives me a little bit more working time on the wood, because this was kind of an intricate assembly to attach this to the front piece of the slide rail, then get a bolt in to this piece, and then kind of slide and glue it into position against the front piece. Then finally attach this, and it may not be obvious on the video. I'm gonna have to show you the pictures, but here and here, you can see a little bit through the glue, there's a black spot there. There are tangs on these clamps. Let me show you another example. You can see how these fittings flare out. Like, there's about 1/8 inch overage tang on the clamps themselves. And that's what is secured with those little cutouts, is this edge, okay, this piece. And so with that 1/8 inch cutout, these blocks actually physically lock the clamp body tightly against the surface of the initial, or what's the best way to put this? The contact portion of the slide rail that contacts the piece that we'll be dadoing. That physical clamping force is not what I'm relying on, of course. I actually shot a couple of screws into the clamp body itself, through the clamp body and into this front piece of the rail. And then there's the large 2.5 or 2 3/4 inch lag bolt that you also saw in the earlier segment that bolts through in this direction and down into the larger of the rear body pieces of the T-rail. The glue, I've been allowing it just to set up and cure because it's been cold out here. I'm sure the adhesive in these joints is probably dry, but I had gooped quite a bit. Boy, this is hard to maneuver on the bench. In here as filler. Not absolutely necessary. That's still a little spongy in spots, so I've been just leaving it go. I'm going to finish this tomorrow. The reason I gooped it in there, it was actually twofold. One, I'd squeezed a little bit too much out of the tube. Two, I wanted to make sure that I had coated every possible crevice, because in addition to the screws and the lag bolt holding this in place and the little tangs holding it in place, these edges here and here come into contact with both pieces of the rear section of the slide rail. and it wasn't a perfect fit, so I just slathered the construction adhesive. I had a big dollop on it, on the mixer board I had. I just slathered it in there in hopes of getting even better adhesion. I don't suppose it matters, but I don't want this thing coming loose. Okay, quickly, I wanted to try to show you what how I attached the body of the clamp. And I drilled a hole at about a 45 degree angle. I put one here, drilling about like this, through the body of the clamp and down into the back of the T-rail. Drilled a pilot hole. I don't remember the size, 3/16 maybe. And I used a 1 1/4 inch wood screw that would go in there. But I placed it on what is, from your viewpoint, the top side drilled in this way. On the opposite side of the tang, I drilled in on the bottom edge of the tang, again, but in at a 45, but 45 in the opposite direction. So there's about, I don't know, that's about a 1/2 or 3/4 inch separation. So the two screws effectively cross in the wood, like that. Then once I had those holes drilled, you saw the bolt, the lag bolt in the earlier segment, I placed the body of the clamp against the end of the rear piece of the T-rail. And I traced out the location of everything, figured out where the bolt would fit, and kind of weaseled it down in there, and then just tapped on the end of it to create a mark. Then I pre-drilled this hole to the depth I wanted, and slightly smaller than the lag bolt, but not much. I wanted the threads to have a good bite, but I didn't want to risk splitting because I was drilling into end grain. So with that hole drilled and the back end of the T-rail and the two alignment holes drilled for the butt joint of the plate in the front portion of the T-rail, I started my assembly. So I put some construction adhesive here, gooping these cavities full so that I got a lot of construction adhesive in there. I shot the two wood screws. I apologize for this. I wish I had been able to film it, but I was racing to try to get it done. Put it on there and then shot in my wood screws from the opposite sides. That held the body of the clamp piece in place. Fished in the lag bolt and, excuse me, and using first the DeWalt drill and then a wrench, I cranked the lag bolt in to the block of wood. I did not attach that backing T-rail piece when I did that, however. It was kind of flopping around. I didn't tighten up the bolt. I left it with some play so then I could coat that joint between the rear portion of the T-rail and the front portion of the T-rail with adhesive. And again, I just used construction adhesive because that's what I was using for this. Put a good healthy coating on there, put it on, stuck on a clamp, aligned that rear block, and then clamped it. Then, using the wrenches, I drove the lag bolt the rest of the way in, making sure that I got the head of it below the surface here. That's important because the other rear portion of the slide rail has to sit like this. So I've now got this glued and screwed on. I've got it bolted and glued to the rear portion of the slide rail. I then simply slathered some glue on this portion of the joint and attached the shorter rear portion of the slide rail. Once those were together and clamped, and you saw the profusion of clamps in the earlier clip, I had a bunch of excess construction adhesive that I squeezed out of the tube. Using a scrap of wood, I just packed the whole joint full. All right, I hope this will be clear. This is the only sketch I made for the jig. Everything else I was just doing on the fly and out of my head. Here you have kind of an overhead view of the jig itself. This black blob here is the clamp body that became part of the jig. Okay. You can see here is the guide rail that the piece to be dadoed slides on, and so the whole jig sort of hangs on it that way. This is the guide fence for the circular saw. This is the portion that the shoe of the circular saw will ride on. I have some dimensions here, but they're only rough and they're going to vary based on your saw. I made my entire saw board 7 inches wide and I think 15 inches long. The reason I chose the 15 inches was because the polyethylene cutting board I had was 20 by 15, so I decided to cut a 15-inch chunk off the one edge. That's what drove that decision. Plus, 15 is enough to span a 2x10. And with the thickness of the guide rail, the slide rail or clamping rail, I really should call it a clamping rail. That's a good name for it. That's really what it is. But with the thickness of that and a 2x10, there was still enough room to start your cut with a circular saw. So you could do dados in a 2x10 with this. Don't know about a 2x12. Here is a drawing of the 1/8 inch by 1/8 inch rabbet that is put into each piece here of the clamp rail. All right, here's the longer piece, here's the shorter end piece. This is the 3-inch, or I had 2 3/4 laying around, lag bolt that goes through the body of the clamp, through here. But it was the best way I could come up with to try to tightly secure it to the entirety of the clamping rail. I knew that the two smaller screws that were shot through in a crisscross fashion through the foot of the clamping pad were not going to be enough structurally to hold it in place under abuse. They were really put in there more to provide initial alignment and initial securing so I could assemble the jig and get this attached and then futz with the rest of the steps. So that's the steps I went through, but I hope maybe this clarifies the layout and my design thinking. Again, I made this up as I went. This wasn't a grand plan. I didn't do any modeling. I just doodled this together to sort of keep my head straight on how I wanted to try. If this had failed, I'd have had to come up with another way to attach this guy to the jig body. Okay. Looks like the glue has set up. Try to back off these clamps a little bit. Boy, it's a lot lighter when you take the clamps off. Well, it's going to be subjected to abuse. If that would have knocked something off, not much I could have done. There it is. It's constructed, as you saw earlier, from 5/8 inch plywood, because I had some pieces of it laying around, a piece of the high-density polyethylene off of a cutting board. I sewed in an earlier video. You can get these this size for about $8 at Sam's Club. Lots and lots of uses for those. The Harbor Freight clamp. Let's see. Too much squeeze out. That surface looks good. Right. Let's get an idea of the dimensions on this thing. Again, I cut this 15 inches simply because that was the width of the cutting board that I had. The width, overall width, this worked out to be about 7 inches, and the gap to the edge here is about 3 7/8, so I'm going to have to shave a little bit off there on my first cut with the circular saw. That should get clean. You'll have to adjust it for your saw. This piece here is just about 12 inches exactly. I'm going to trim a little bit off here. There was some excess, and you can see where I boogered up my first attempt to cut that recess for the tang of the clamp. So I just flipped it end for end, cut a new one, put it in there. I'll shave that even on the probably on the bandsaw. It'd be the easiest. But that's looking pretty good. So now all I gotta do is sand it, throw on a coat of varnish, install the end of the clamp and the bar, and try it out. is why a clean shop is important. Tighten that down so it doesn't move. Now, let's see if we got enough clearance here. Bobby the saw. Yeah, that's good. Okie dokie. Hearing protection on. Eye protection on. Time to make the cleanup cut. Now, since I've taped that up so it's easier to get started, don't set the saw down with the blade spinning, especially don't let it rest against your leg. That would be bad. Now, I'm just going to do a test run without running the saw. I haven't even sanded the surface of that, and with the bottom of the saw all slicked up with wax, boy, that slides nicely. Okay, here is the offcut that I trimmed free with that first trimming cut. And I don't know how well this is going to show up on the camera, but that is a nice, clean, even thickness piece. So that makes me happy. That tells me a couple things. One, the saw is riding smoothly. I got a clean cut on it. There was no binding. I know you can't tell, but boy, that thing was sliding easily. Once I sand this down, varnish it, and then butter this with some heavy layers of wax, it should slide across there like it's on wheels. The second thing it tells me is that I have my fence set parallel to the original edge that I'd based everything off of. I got a nice clean cut edge, straight, and I based the parallel lines of this fence, and actually the main support fence, off of that line, and I did the 90 degree check for square of the clamping guide or clamping rail against that edge. The fact that this all stayed true makes me very happy. Okay, the only other thing I'll point out about this is when you're designing it for your particular saw, it's very important and critical, in fact, to take into account how far the motor body extends out on your saw. That's important in terms of clearance here under the saw body against the rail. That's why I went with a pretty shallow depth fence. But the critical part for making this clamp is you've got to make sure you've got enough clearance here. Sorry about the jostling. But when you grab hold of that, that you've got enough room to slide the saw past not only the clamp body, but your hand. And if your hand's in here holding this, you can see I called it just about as close as I could get it. I actually run it up there like that. I did this test a couple of times, so it's actually touching my hand there. But I can twist a little bit out of the way and, you know, finish my cut. It's not a big deal. But bear that in mind when you're doing the measurements for your saw. Wish I had dust collection.